Okay, it's a little past 1 o'clock, so I think we'll go ahead and get started. There are some agendas on the table out there and also a report on some of our work in New York that I think people, looks like a lot of people have gotten those. What I'm going to do is give you a little introduction to Southwest Pennsylvania Environmental Health Project. And my name is Celia Lewis. I'm a research and communications specialist with the Environmental Health Project. I also want to introduce my colleagues here. Beth Weinberger is also a research and communications specialist with EHP, and her expertise is in maternal and child health. Sujeet Joganpally is our program manager for one of our big New York State projects that's looking at compressor station impacts. He has a great deal of medical expertise, so we're very happy that he could come and be with us today. And Dr. David Brown is the public health toxicologist for the Environmental Health Project. I also want to take a minute to thank the organizers of this event. There were quite a few people who came together to make this happen. I want to thank Rose Wells. She was my main point person in getting this organized for us. Also, Kurt Norgaard, who could not be here today. He's over from the Cambridge-Boston area. Alice Arena, Nick Katkovich, Jane Wynn. Some of these people I haven't yet met in person, but I hope to if you're here today. But we've done a lot of emailing back and forth. And also locally, I know we had a lot of support from Ben Clark of Clarkdale Fruit Farm, and he's offered the cider and apples that are out on the table, and we can enjoy more of those during the break. Carolyn Ness, who is on the Deerfield Select Board and helped sponsor this event, so thanks very much to the board for that. Scott Dredge is assistant principal of the high school here, and he made this venue available to us, so we appreciate that. Chris Collins of FCAT, which is the Community Access Channel, will be filming this event. Deerfield Police is here to help with traffic control, people control. And I know a lot of people volunteered to bring the food that's out on the table. So thank you very much to everyone for making this happen. Okay, so a little bit about EHP. This organization was founded in 2011. The process of horizontal drilling in shale started to ramp up in Pennsylvania in about 2008. So it had been going on for a few years before we got started, and communities were really struggling with how to deal with this industry that was moving into the landscape and into the region with drill rigs, with frack ponds, processing plants, compressor stations, and they weren't getting a lot of support from the usual resources you might go to. So this organization was formed to respond to the need. Let's see. This was our mission: to respond to individuals and communities' need for access to accurate, timely, trusted public health information and health services. And that trust and accuracy really is critical, and we felt that that's what people were not getting access to before EHP showed up in Southwest Pennsylvania. EHP really has two main types of services. We provide health evaluation and support. We have a nurse practitioner in Pennsylvania who can offer health exams, consultations, referrals for health services. We also do health provider education, and we're working on clinical toxicity profiles for residents. We also have a pretty large, extensive public health outreach. We work on the identification of exposure pathways for residents. We provide measurement tools for air exposure and water exposure. Interpretation of lab reports. A lot of people go get their water tested or have air samples taken, and you get a report back from the lab, and you're not really sure what it means. So we often help with that sort of information as well. So we do this. These are just a few of some of the main things we do for people in Pennsylvania. And of course, it turns out that the problem is much larger than just in Southwest Pennsylvania or Pennsylvania. It's quite extensive out west in Colorado, Texas, in the Dakotas. Even Florida now is looking at possibly fracking. So we've had a lot of requests from people around the country, including recently in New England, from different cities and communities and states in New England. So we decided to see if we could come to one place and share what we know with people from a number of states in this region. And so today we'll be talking about compressor stations in particular, what we know about emissions and potential health effects from our work in Pennsylvania and elsewhere in New York State, and also the work that other people have done across the country. First, I do want to point out that I believe some index cards have been handed out, and we'd ask that if you have questions, if you could write them down. We're leaving quite a bit of time at the end of the program so we can answer questions and really have good discussion with you about your questions, your concerns, and what we know that maybe we're not sharing in the slideshow. We'll also take just a few questions right before the break, but most of them we'd like to save till the end of the program. Okay, and with that, I'd like to introduce David Brown. He'll be talking with you primarily about health effects and emissions and how those two things are connected.
Thank you, Celia.
Let me just, so to move the slide, just
push that button. Okay, I can.
Can you?
I don't know that I can do that or not. I'll try this briefly. Hi, my name's Dave Brown. How's that? Okay. I hate talking to mics, but I'll do it. Okay. My name's David Brown, and I'm a toxicologist. I'll give you what I'd like to do in the next 20 minutes or so is explain to you what we found when we went to Southwest Pennsylvania. We were asked to go to Southwest Pennsylvania. We're based in New Haven, and we're public health people, and we were asked to go to Southwest Pennsylvania and look at the health effects that were occurring within people living in Washington County. Washington County is an intensely drilled area in Pennsylvania with many, many compressor stations of different types, but many, many well pads. They don't count wells, they count well pads, and they count them in the hundreds. And each well pad could have on it up to 12 or so gas wells, so that it's intense. We have done a series of things. We actually did a study. We don't do studies necessarily. We collected data from a clinic where we got 279 people, and we asked them to fill out a questionnaire, a system for us that looked at physical and social and psychological well-being, and then we looked at where they were relative to the gas wells to see how they were. How they were doing. So we have that data set, and we don't. Our goal is not to publish scientific research. Our goal is to, if we do something, we do it because we want to We're supposed to be advising people who are being exposed what they can do to protect themselves. We do publish things, and you'll see some of that in just a minute. How many people here are from a town board or that may be considering or thinking about gas drilling, just to get not compressor stations, which is... Oh, okay. Wow, that's... Okay. I guess that's okay. We're going to talk in about 15 minutes or so about Minisink, a compressor station in New York, where we actually went and did our health studies there. But before I do that, I wanted to talk to you a little bit and show you what we found in Southwest Pennsylvania, and in terms of the health issues that we found, and also in terms of the exposures that we found. And we want to explain to you a bit about why those exposures may or may not be evaluated appropriately by the kind of information that we're getting from the federal and state officials. And so our goal is not to stop fracking. Our goal is to protect the public health. We don't think fracking is a terrific idea, but we're not out there as an advocacy group. So I'm going to talk about health concerns Celia has promised me that if I push this button, the slide will change, and it did. That's really great. Okay. These are health concerns and communities exposed to the natural gas from fracking. So what we did is we went in and found people who were highly exposed, people who were near the sites, who were complaining of their health effects, and we sent physicians and nurse practitioners in to talk to those people. We've talked to a large number now. We have data on, we talked to one person per family. We have 185 different people that we've done health intakes on, but the number goes into the hundreds beyond that. We also went to the sites to try to see what kind of exposures they might be having. So we used two instruments to measure their air exposure, and one of those is running up here, measuring the air in this room, which it looks pretty good. And then we also have another instrument that we'll show you a little bit later and how those work. And we try to look at what the linkages might be between those pieces. Fracking shale beds. Fracking is a problem, and the fracking gases are a problem, and the chemicals are a problem. But what we noticed was that when fracking, which takes place in maybe a few weeks to a month, ended, the health effects didn't end. The people who were there, as the gas came up, they were still showing health effects. So we began to be a little bit skeptical about, let's deal with the fracking chemicals. We wondered, what is it that's coming out of the well? We don't have a good answer for that. We got a good suspicion what it is. And we began looking at how close to the wells somebody might be showing health effects, because there was an argument 500 feet was okay, 1,000 feet was okay. Some people were saying half a mile. So we were really interested in how close were these people that were showing these health effects. And we were interested in what kind of health effects were they showing, and what were they doing. In Southwest, over 1.2 million people are living within a half a mile of a shale gas extraction site in Pennsylvania. That's a lot of people. You cannot even, I'm from Vermont, you cannot even begin to imagine how close these people are to those gas sites. The Environmental Health Project you can see it. We're going to focus on the health, the chemicals, and we're going to talk a little bit about pathways of exposure, because I think that's of interest. If somebody's going to put a compressor station next to you, you would like to know how you might be exposed. And we, as I said before, we're interested in personal actions that you can take to protect yourself or to know what might be happening. We're not going to talk a lot about those, but we have a website, and we have a lot of information on our website, and almost everything that Dr. Lewis, Dr. Weinberg, and I do is figuring out how to tell people how to make themselves safer. So that's basically where we are. Okay, first of all, does anything happen? Well, yeah. These are the health effects that you see in people that are there. I'm going to try to turn around. Yell at me if you can't, because this is hard for me to see. Okay. We've broken them down into these areas. These are symptoms that were reported to a nurse practitioner. They're respiratory symptoms. They were not just reported. We are not the only people that saw this. Earthworks have seen it across the country. Yale published a study in environmental health perspectives. There are, in fact, respiratory effects for people living near these sites. There's skin dermatologic effects. There are effects in the eye. The nose and throat seem to be very prevalent. We see gastrointestinal effects, upset stomachs, nausea, vomiting, cardiac effects. Not a lot of them, but when we see them, they're heart palpitations and things like that. We see neurological effects, headaches. When you go to people who have come to us who are living within a half a mile of a gas extraction site or a compressor, 60% of them tell us that they have headaches. They have episodic headaches. And so one might imagine maybe one or two could do it, but it would be really surprising that by chance 60,000 would do that. Everybody is worried and anxiety. And that is the levels that we see is 40% or such. They're worried because they can hear the thing, the noise, they can see the light, and they get the odors. So people are really concerned, and the information that they're getting is basically what they're getting in LA. Don't worry about it. When the odor goes away, you'll be fine. I wouldn't bet on that. Okay. Then there are endocrine effects, and there are also some effects on ears and hearing. So we saw that in our nurse. This is our first group of data that we went out in the first year. We actually didn't think we'd see much, and we were suddenly faced with this data. And we wondered, were we wrong? And it turned out we were not wrong. Other people had found exactly the same thing that we had found. So that, are there health effects in people living near or the gas drilling and living near these, getting exposed to these emissions? The answer to that is almost certainly yes. Are these all the health effects? Almost certainly no. Because we were looking at effects that people experienced immediately. We do not know what's going to happen down the road with these people. We do have a registry that we're trying to put in place to track people who are being exposed across the country. We're making progress. We're not happy as far along as we'd like. The next slide, Dr. Celia Lewis and I have an argument about. I say this is a 12 emissions of immediate toxic response because I like the number 12. And she says, but there's 14 numbers there. And I said, well, you know, it's 12. I've got a PhD, I can say what I want. Okay. I'm not going to try to talk about all these. We heard that there were thousands and hundreds of chemicals involved in fracking. And when you're saying there's thousands and hundreds of chemicals involved in fracking, what you're really saying is there's too many to think about. So we said, okay, there aren't hundreds, there are 12. Well, actually, there's 14. But anyway, and we just wrote them down. So these are what they are. Some of these appear in water. When water supplies get contaminated, they are very contaminated and people get very sick. VOCs, I've asterisked because VOCs, we're learning more about VOCs. They are released from compressor stations. They are released from pipelines, and so you will see VOCs there. We'll talk a little bit about them. Polyaromatic hydrocarbons, they're carcinogens, benzene, toluene, xylenes, what the other are. The next two chemicals are two chemicals, 6 and 7, that we really think are a problem. They would explain some of the health effects that we're seeing, but we're not sure. We measure fine particulate matter. When you run lots of diesel engines, when you release a lot of gas and burn it, you produce a lot of particulate. That instrument right there is measuring particulate matter in this room. We measure particulate matter for 34 days for every minute at every site that we go to. So when asked, do you know what's going on with the particulate? We have a pretty good idea. We got about 200 sites that we've looked at so far. The glycols are used to dry the gas, and they're also used along the pipeline, we think. And then there's radioactivity present. Almost nobody has thought about the radioactivity that's present in that gas, and the radium present, and the radium and the radon that's present in the gas. Then there's hydrogen sulfide and nitrogen oxides, which are already there. I want to move a little bit faster. The chemicals come from both the fracking fluids and from the gas. When they fracture the rock, in the rock, chemicals that have been working for under high temperature and pressure for about 300 million years are now released. If you have a trouble understanding what 300 million years means, you evolved as mammals 200 million years ago. So it's been there a long time. And the exposure pathways that we see in Pennsylvania are air emissions from flaring, fugitive emissions, and blowdowns. And we see blowdowns, and sometimes I don't think we see very much flaring on the pipeline, but we do that. We see water emissions from waste and such. We do not know whether water is going to get into gas, is going to get into the water here. And then we look at soil and fallout exposure, because there's a lot of, in Washington County, there's a lot of organic farming, and the organic farmers want to know if they're safe. Well, the first surprise that we found was that the government had been in measuring. Every 6 days, they would measure 24 hours around these sites, and they would come back and say, there's no real anything really going on there, and when we average it out for the year, there's not much exposure. And we said, oh, that's nice. Let's look and see when we set a meter up, and this kind of meter was set up. We set up a meter for 2 weeks, and this is what we saw. We saw that what happens is there are episodes of extremely high exposures. Those peaks that you see there are not artifacts. That's what happens at almost every time we put up a site. They're there because the air system is changing over time. So if the air stagnates here, and you've seen it here in Deerfield or wherever you're from, when you get up in the morning, there's a fog in the morning, nothing's moving, everything's laying on the air. Ground. If you've got a compressor station next to you, that stuff is laying on the ground next to you too. The wind blows and it goes away. The state comes by and measures at noon to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. They say there's nothing there. And then at night you wake up and you've got the odor in your house again. We were interested in how serious that was. And these are peak exposures. And we've written a paper on peak exposures that you'll get to see. And then we actually have a model so we can identify when they're going to occur. We think that's extremely important, particularly if people are going to measure for you. You've got to have them measuring at the time when the exposures are the highest. Okay. This next slide, I'm going to turn around. I'm not going to say anything, but I'll turn around and say something. Okay. Okay. There are 14 instances here. These are actually measurements in houses or near houses. And the number of hours with a peak over, I think that's a 2 week period, that they occur. They don't occur all the time, they occur at brief intervals. And the maximum values you'll see on the far left hand side. So if you look here on the right hand side, you'll see that you're supposed to be getting 50 counts. This is measuring counts. It's about 50. When those peaks go up, those numbers right there are what people are exposed to. Those are immense exposures. We now know that they occur about once every nine hours. They occur, the time between them is around 10 or 12 hours. The peaks are, we know what the peaks are, we know what the baseline is, and we know basically what the exposure would be. And the numbers I just give you are numbers inside of houses that are near these sites. Outside of houses, it's a little bit different. But our first concern was people were complaining in the middle of the night, and we said, you're not out running around in the middle of the night getting exposed. What's going on in your house? And we measure inside of houses and outside of houses to look at what those exposures might be. And you'll notice the letters there just refer to morning, noon, night, or something else, some code, but you can see how that is. But they're all showing it. It's 14 houses. They're all showing it. It is not an artifact. And we can show it to you in 100 houses if you want to see it. Okay? And here's what happens. When the peaks go up, the symptoms go up. So the symptoms were episodic, the peaks were episodic, and we tried to get people to keep a diary of when they were getting a symptom so we could match it against this. I'll tell you something, anybody with a teenage daughter knows that getting them to keep a diary is important and is impossible, but try to get an adult to keep a diary. They do not do that, so we failed. Okay, what are they getting exposed to? What they're getting, this is what's coming out. These are data not from us. These are reported from the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection, and the industry is required to report to them what they are releasing over time. And you'll see the chemicals that are being released are listed there, the different kinds. And I'm going to just try to see if I can see them with my glasses off here, maybe.
Okay.
The largest block is the blue one is VOCs. That's a group of chemicals, and the VOCs are volatile organic hydrocarbons. They will be in the air and they will travel some distance. The next two you see, the green and the pink, are PM2.5, what we're measuring with our instrument. And then there's a series of other chemicals that are also present. They're in the gas. The primary agents in the gas, though, are methane, because that's what they're selling. There's also carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, that's there, and nitrogen oxides. And they are the largest component. If I put those there on this graph, there would be just a little sliver showing these pieces here. But remember, there's millions of cubic feet of gas being released. So the interesting thing was, what's being released from compressor stations? And I think we began getting a call from people who live near compressor stations telling us what their health effects were. And we kept saying, nah, that's gas drilling health effects. And so we didn't believe them. We're skeptical. So we did go look at a compressor station mini sink. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. But I wanted you to see what it is that's released by compressor stations. Okay? Those are the chemicals that are being released. There's toluene, xylene, benzene, ethylbenzene, and a variety of other chemicals. They are the station vents. And it vents all the time. And occasionally it's blown down. And it's blown down every so many days, weeks, hours, months, years, depending on who you're listening to. And you have these effects. So these are the chemicals that are being released in the air along these venting stations, by the compressor stations. They're also being released by the metering stations. We have a report where we reviewed, that we'll make available if you would like it. We reviewed what we know about compressor stations and what we know about the science of compressor stations and the health related to that. We've got that we prepared at the Environmental Health Project, and that's available to you. It's exactly online if you want it. And one of the questions was, so there's peaks, so what? Which is a really good question. And this is what happens. If the PM, the peaks that we're seeing are identified on that side, the symptoms are identified here, and you'll notice that the more peaks that we had, and this is a group of how this was collected in New Haven. We were in New Haven reviewing data, health data. We reviewed the health data in New Haven. We're reviewing the health data, and we're also looking at the number of peaks. And Brian Goda, who is our environmental educator, afterwards said, "Dave, did you know that they look like that?" And I said, "No." But it appears as the more peaks you get, the higher symptoms that you get. So whatever's happening, it seems to be consistent. We don't know everything to know about it. So the question we asked ourselves is, how is it that when we do our look at our stuff in Southwest Pennsylvania, our health findings show respiratory, neurologic, dermal effects, vascular bleeding, abdominal pain, nausea, and vomiting? Those are the predominant things we see. But on the other side, the government and the industry and industry scientists are saying there isn't anything there at all. The reason that we think the reason they're seeing that is because they are looking, they're averaging all the effects over time, and they're saying there couldn't possibly be enough there to show any effects. And they're also not looking at short-term peaks. Our peaks are about 2 to 3 hours long. I'm sorry, they're a half hour to 2 hours long when they occur, then they go away. But if you're an asthmatic and you get exposed to a high level of PM2.5 for half an hour, it will be a serious situation. Okay, now, going pretty quickly because we can talk further about this in a minute. What are the health issues associated with unconventional natural gas and the implications for healthcare providers? A lot of our work is trying to provide guidance to physicians who are trying to treat people near these sites. So we spend a considerable amount of time to do. What evidence would cause a provider to be concerned? We're looking at that data right now, and it looks like if you get a headache, if you get two or three systems responding at the same time, that would be enough for a health provider to be concerned about. Now, Dr. Giampoli is going to may talk for a little bit. When I said to him they've got headaches, he's a physician. He says, "Oh well, let me talk about headaches." Don't get him talking about headaches because he'll talk to you because you say, "Are they? When did they occur? How long did they occur? What did you do to treat them?" All that information you need to know, rather than just checking a box that says headaches. So we now know that. And what characteristics define the health issues and of immediate concern? And what do we need to do to mitigate the damage? Remember, our job, we have a director who is a lovely woman, but she is very demanding. She says, "You're here to help people. You're not here to write scientific papers." So we say, "Yes, Raina, we understand that." But anyway. The analysis shows the protocols, this is just very briefly, I'll read it to you. The analysis that we have shows that protocols used for addressing compliance with ambient air standards that are currently being used by the industry and by the government and by FERC are just not adequate. And the reason for that is the intensity thing I mentioned before. We do not know the chemicals that are released. We have an idea what they are. The industry does not release that. That's confidential information, I guess. The National Ambient Air Quality Standards, which is being used as a standard, do not protect against short-term peaks. The standards used for acute toxics are not available for most of the compounds. Most of the compounds that we're seeing, nobody even knows what they are, what they do, so we couldn't say very much about that. But basically what we've said, let's go back to the fundamentals. I'm a fundamental person. I worked at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. I said, This is a health outbreak. We know how to deal with health outbreaks. You go ask the sick people what's wrong with them. You look at what they're being exposed to, and then you figure out how to take care of them. And then you write a scientific paper in 10, 12 years if you still want to do that. So we think the timing and intensity is a really important problem. We have another problem in Southwest Pennsylvania, and that is non-disclosure agreements. We do not get to see the sickest people because the sickest people have been signing non-disclosure agreements. They have to because they have to get away. They need the money, and they are not allowed to talk about their health effects or their children's health effects. So I think, if anything, we are underestimating what we're seeing. But we've got a large enough sample size, number of people have contributed. We now their information to us. We now think we have a pretty good idea what to do. Well, in the middle of this, I'm going to lapse over to Beth. In the middle of this, a health director from a county in New York, Madison County, called us and said, "You guys seem to know a lot about what's going on." We said, whatever. "Would you help me read this report that I've been given to approve this compressor station thing?" And you're going to talk about that? Okay. And so we said, "Sure." I didn't say sure. I said, "We don't have time to do that." Beth and Celia, though, do stuff when they're asked to do it. So Beth is going to explain what she found at that particular site, what the industry said back to us, and then what the industry consultant said back to us. All I think will be really kind of interesting to you. Okay. And remember, if you have questions, write them down, and we're going to allow time for you to ask them.
Oh, yeah. No, you can. I think so. Yeah.
Internet off?
I don't know. I don't have to.
I think if you close it, it'll go black.
Okay. So you don't want me to do that. Okay. So as David Brown said, we were approached by a health director in New York State because a company was filing with FERC, Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, to site a compressor station within his county. And after the company submits an application, then there's a comment period. And during that comment period, stakeholders, community members, really anyone can submit comments. And so he wanted to submit comments, and he asked us if we could analyze the application so he could better address what makes him concerned about protecting the public health for people in the surrounding area. So, and as a side note, FERC is actually not responsible for protecting public health, but it's sort of the only avenue people have often. So if FERC is really responsible for safely and efficiently getting the gas through the pipeline. But it's sort of where you can intervene, so it's where we try to intervene. So we carefully read the 800-page application that was submitted by this company. And really, we found what we've come to expect from oil and gas industry folks. Our analysis fell into about six categories. And the reason I'm talking about them here is because I don't think it's unique, what we saw, what this company applied for, and what we did. And so I think it's probably pretty applicable to other communities across the country, really. The overwhelming standout problem that we saw was it just wasn't a convincing case that the public's health was protected in the plans that this company was putting forth. The burden of proof seemed to lie on, instead of relying on the company or the state or federal officials to prove that it was safe, the burden of proof really was landing at the county level and at communities to try to prove that it was unsafe. And there's obviously quite a big power differential. When looking at the application, we saw first that the company didn't adequately characterize the emissions, the contaminants that were going to be in the air. They didn't characterize them well in terms of the content or in terms of the concentration. And we know from states that have looked at it, and David Brown talked about it, that we don't know everything. There's still sort of a cloud of uncertainty, but we know a lot. And there's a lot more I think they could have said. And one of the concerns we have, especially with the gas coming up from the Marcellus Shale in Pennsylvania area, is we think that the radioactive material really is not being addressed, and certainly wasn't addressed in this application. The projected emissions for operational emissions were really just sort of the ongoing compressor engine emissions, but we're really concerned also about venting that goes on and blowdowns, which is a term for when they need to clear an area of the pipe near the compressor station, either for maintenance or to change the pressure or whatever. You know, some we don't necessarily know. But they'll block off an area of the pipe, and they'll just blow out whatever's in there. So imagine living across the street from this thing. And there's not nearly enough known about what's coming out of that pipeline when they blow it. It's the company addressed blowdowns in terms of noise, which is a problem. People say it's unbelievably, it's like a freight train. But they didn't address it in terms of emissions, and so they talked more in terms of tons per year. So, you know, what did they say? 6.4 tons per year of particulate matter. But people don't experience these emissions in tons per year. They experience them in these high peaks that come periodically and are particularly bad during these blowdowns. The other thing that's not well characterized and not known enough is the companies tend to say when they look at research that we look at, that we're looking at compressor stations that are right on the shale plays, and that gas is a lot dirtier, and that's where the problems are. And by the time it gets to New York State, for instance, it's really cleaned up. It's pipeline-ready gas. But we don't know that. And so again, the burden of proof isn't on the company to say, yes, we've fully evaluated it, or frankly, for the states to say, yes, we have fully evaluated this. We know it's very different by the time it hits New York or Massachusetts or Connecticut. So we were relying on data often from the sort of fracking states. But it's the best we can do. And, you know, our feeling is we can wait for these long epidemiologic studies and long environmental studies. But in the meantime, we operate on whatever information we can get. And that information does not make us comfortable. In the application, and this is very common, they'll measure their emissions against national ambient air quality standards, which were intended to look at regional air quality over time. It was not, those standards were not created to look at a particular industrial site in a neighborhood with women, children, elderly. I mean, in Pennsylvania, stuff is sited 500 yards from schools and daycares. And so to say over the course of a year, you're in compliance, projected compliance, with these regional air standards is really, it's not useful. In the application, they also talk about some other hazardous air pollutants, which I think I think they're the benchmark is the national, emissions standards. And those standards are in part created with the idea that they need to have limits that industries can comply with. So those are often set a little bit high because they can't undercut industrial activity by setting them too low. The other thing which is really absent from the application, as we would figure, is a thorough discussion of the potential health effects. And so I think we've made our case that we have a lot of concerns about potential health effects. So we wrote up our report and we worked with the team in this county in New York, and then they submitted it. And after reviewing all the comments, FERC, and we think this is quite an unusual step, but FERC actually asked the company to do an evaluation of what we said and respond. So we took that as a compliment. And so they hired a big national, international firm to look at the concerns that that we had written up about this compressor station. And so they responded at length. I think their response was twice as long as our report. And they said what we expected them to say. They said that their emissions are adequately characterized. They are below levels set by the EPA in New York State. They dismissed the possibility of radioactive material. They said that these are upstream, these are downstream compressor stations, so they're obviously much cleaner. They didn't like the data that we were using to show that there may be pretty serious health effects because they said the studies weren't conducted well. And again, we don't have time for long epidemiologic studies. We and other groups across the country are doing the best we can by talking to people who are having health effects. So they dismissed the health effects concerns. And then they also said that people don't really spend all their time at home anyway. So we were not persuaded by their arguments. So we created a small sort of response. But it, you know, and our response is sort of our mantra. You know, in a situation with even uncertain, in this level of uncertainty, you have to act, and you have to act to protect public health. And so that's kind of been our, that was sort of our final response. FERC then conducted a environmental assessment of the project. This compressor station was part of a sort of larger project. And the environmental assessment is actually sort of a lighter assessment than we would have liked to have seen, which is a full environmental impact statement. And again, this is because FERC's not really responsible for evaluating the public's health. And so after that, there's also a comment period. And so we commented, really our comments were centered on 4 points, mostly because we only had a certain amount of time to write it up. And in that case, we felt like the environmental assessment should not have been substituted for an environmental impact statement, which would have gone much further in depth. The health risk assessment included didn't consider the full range of emissions or exposures that would occur to community members. They dismissed an argument about environmental justice, and they used misleading comparisons with being on a rider lawnmower for 7 days was akin to whatever. So taken together, we, you know, again, felt like it really missed the mark in terms of thinking about and protecting public health. The project, however, is going forward and is sort of as we speak, and Celia will talk a lot about that after we take a break. So that, you know, it is sort of a failure in that these interventions didn't stop the process. It did have an impact on FERC such that they actually had the company look at our responses and address them. But I have to say, mostly, we still think it's important to talk to officials, to write in your comments, to get them to FERC, to get them to state officials, because I think the more we know and the more you all know about the risks, the more impact it will have. So we're still big fans of trying to intervene when you can, and it's, you know, for us, it's still breaking, you know, anytime you can break the chain of exposure, you do. And if you can actually do that by keeping the compressor station if you can keep it from being sited in the first place, you know, that's sort of the ideal breaking of the exposure. But short of that, we have ideas about how to address it sort of as time goes forward and if a compressor station is being sited. And so that's, I think, going to be the bulk of the after break discussion. And then I'm going to hop back to our table. But if you all have maybe just a few questions we can do now, and then we're going to save, Celia said, a big chunk of time at the end if people have questions.
If you have questions specific to the information we've been talking about so far, probably best to try and address those now and save some for later. So, yeah, would you?
I just want to know sort of what you had said about these specific people who paid off to move or something like that. What did you mean by that? They were paid off by the company?
I think you got to go to a mic.
Yeah.
Yeah, she said, what was I saying? Sicker people were being paid off. Oh. Paid off is a strong term. That what they were doing was they were given, I guess paid off is right. The industry would come to them and would say, okay, for example, there may be an accident near them, or they've been ill, or there were lots of complaints. One site we had, in Pennsylvania, there was a community where somebody had lost, walking to his mailbox, had walking back, lost consciousness. And so they actually went to that, it was a street, and then they paid, we don't know the actual amount, but we think they were paid somewhere between $35,000 and $45,000 to move, providing they paid a non-disclosure agreement. And I don't know about the money amount, but it was certainly in that range. And so although we were following some of those people, once that happened, we were not allowed to follow them anymore. But their non-disclosure agreements are all over Pennsylvania. In fact, there are legal discussions about non-disclosure agreements in Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
Can I ask you, what do your findings have to do with the ones that you showed us were a 12,000 horsepower turbine?
Yeah.
And is it a straight line? Does that mean it's going to be 4 times more VOCs in a particular pattern?
The correct answer to your question, it'll be more. Yeah, okay. We're going to talk to you about mini sync right after the break. And it's a 12,000 horsepower station. They're talking about 40,000 horsepower. It's the highest one we've seen is 80 or 90,000 horsepower. And the question was, are the effects linear from, and will they be? The answer to that question is we don't know. We have not measured them. I would, as a toxicologist, think they're going to be higher in terms of more people will be exposed and people may be more ill if you think about the amount of material that they would be exposed to. The answer to the real question, nobody knows. That's what the New York project that we're also going to describe to you a little bit is about, finding that answer to that question. Yeah, I'll answer that. The answer to the question is, when the small fine particles are in the air, how far will they travel, and is there a study that looks at that? Is that it?
Yes.
And the answer to that is, yeah, there are studies on that. There are studies along, small particles are released along highways, and so people have actually looked how far away from a highway you could get exposure. And so we know what that is. The smaller the particle is, the longer it stays in the air, as you would imagine. The particles of the size that they're getting here, which are down in the 0.5, very small, 0.5 microns is half a micron, two and a half microns is the width of a human hair. 0.5 is real small stuff. It begins to act like a gas. And because it acts like a gas, although they're particles, they get in the deep lung. And because they get in the deep lung, they also absorb to the outside the toxic chemicals, so they carry the toxic chemicals to the deep lung. How far do they travel? We have modeled some of that. We're thinking 2.5 to 6 miles. Yeah, right here. Actually, one of our tasks is to follow the literature. We have a group working with us to keep up with the literature. The question was, what about the radioactivity, and are the picocuries that are being correct, or are they being too high? Are they being understated? I think, sir, that was the gist of what you were saying. We've looked at the, we have a person, actually, we put together a report on radioactivity that I haven't reviewed yet, but it's present. But one thing that's clear is that there's radon in the gas. The other thing that's not so clear is that the breakdown products of radon are also in the gas. And the breakdown products of radon are not being measured by anything, anybody, anywhere. And the breakdown products are what cause the cancer. So the best answer is we don't really know, but we know it's there. We know that radium is there, and because radium has been seen in the water. Some of it we think is removed when they dewater the gas. We don't know how much that is because it hasn't been measured. And one of the things that we are constantly trying to get is information on what is it that's being released so we can figure out what's going on. We don't have good information. My strongest statement was we need more direct measurements of what's going on with radioactivity. Yep, back there.
Can physicians share their data anonymously?
You're talking about Pennsylvania's You have to live in Pennsylvania, guys. I lived in Vermont, and I now live in Connecticut. The state legislature in Pennsylvania passed a law, I don't remember the name, Act something, 18, something like that.
Act 13,
that the information the industry had was their information. If you were sick, your physician could contact the industry, and they could give, the industry could give some information to the physician about what was making you sick. But Act 13 said your physician was financially and legally bound not to pass that information on to you or to your other doctors or other people. That was stomped on by the Medical Association of Pennsylvania. So I don't, no one talks very much about it. But in fact, it is possible that your physician would not be able to pass information on if you, it, because suppose, you know, if you, suppose you have heart palpitations, you go to a cardiologist, the cardiologist, you know, it's just stupid. Can we get data from physicians? For some physicians, we have physicians working for us. Physicians review our data. There's published papers that talk about, that medical people have put out. There's a paper on reproductive risks and low birth weight children that were, that is put out. There isn't, in my view, a blockage of flow for information to us and from us from the medical professions of Pennsylvania. I absolutely am confident that if they have something that they want people to know, they can let us know. So there isn't a block in that way. But when you go and look at their data, there's recently a paper of low birth weights for people living in Washington County from this. And so that raises a question, is a pregnant woman safe near these sites or their child?
I think we'll take maybe one more and then we'll take a break.
You're so enthusiastic.
The question. Okay. Is there a way that we can access the slide projections that you're doing?
Yes.
Yeah, we're going to give them to you. We'll give them to you.
They'll be available. I think Rose knows more about that.
Yeah, jump in, Rose.
Okay. If you go to nofrackgasinmass.org, I'll make them available there. Also, if you want to look for the video of this presentation, it'll be on www.fcat.tv. That's FCAT for Frontier Community Access Television. And I'll make sure to get the slides up as well as the video on the front page of No Frack Gas in Mass. Thanks.
Oh,
go ahead.
You want to answer another?
No, I just want to stop.
You want to stop? Okay, Dave wants to stop. We're going to stop. So we can have some refreshments and come back in 5 minutes. Okay, I think we have just about everybody back with us. Thank you for sticking around. I'm going to start with a story about MiniSink and how we got there to do a study. MiniSink is actually the name of the compressor station, which is located in the in Westtown, New York. And I have to say, we were, as you have heard, very, very focused on Pennsylvania, Southwest Pennsylvania in particular, because there is so much going on there. We were working with people living very close to well pads and frack ponds in their backyards, and we were monitoring their health and their air, and we really trying to figure out, you know, how these, what sources were causing different kinds of impacts, to see if we could figure that out. But we kept getting these, this phone calls and emails from a woman in Westtown, New York. And she'd say, you know, there's really something going on here. You really got to come and help us here. And we'd say, well, we don't really have time right now, but maybe later. So she'd call back send more emails and say, you know, we have this compressor. We tried to keep it from being built, but they've built it anyway, and people are really feeling the effects. We really need your help. No one will help us in New York State. They won't come, look at the site, address our concerns. So this kept going on, and so finally we just did have to stop and sit down and say, okay, what can we do about this site? And it was really when we had the time to sit down and focus on it that we realized, I would say that was a moment for me when I looked at the map, I looked at the pipeline maps, and you realize how widespread this is and that it's getting more widespread, more built up, and that it's really not just the areas where the fracking is happening, that these are going to get to be bigger and bigger issues unless they're dealt with in the right way. So it expanded our view quite a bit. And then we also realized that it was a great opportunity to take a look at one industrial installation and be able to get a sense of what the emissions and what the health impacts would be from just one source. Because in Pennsylvania, you really can't do that anymore. There's so many sites around where people live. So that's how we got to Minisink. It was really because of a very effective community organizer. And so this is a shout out to her and her effectiveness and to all the people here who I think are probably very active and very involved in making a difference. So that role of community organizer, I would say, is really the key to what makes our work possible and very effective. It's the person in the community who can recruit participants for the types of studies and projects we're able to do. They organize the meetings, sometimes help with the monitoring that we have to do, or find the right technical and scientific people who can be there on the ground doing that. And they also help us find the medical personnel that we require in the work we do to review health surveys with participants. So we know that the information we're getting is accurate, and we can give them timely information as well about health impacts. So that role is really critical to anywhere we go. At Minisink, what we did, there were 8 families that were willing to participate around the compressor station. It is a 12,000 horsepower site. And we had health surveys of adults and children. We did PM2.5 monitoring indoors and outdoors of homes. And for this one, we used the SPEC monitor, which is, we could also plug that one in. Okay, you look for a plug. This is the kind of monitor that we've been using more recently. But both the Dialos and the SPEC are quite effective at monitoring PM2.5. We also did VOC sampling. We had a suite of about 60 chemicals that you can capture in a SUMA canister. Those are 12-hour samples that we would do during certain weather conditions that we thought were most appropriate for capturing emissions that would be hanging around. So that's usually it's usually nighttime when the winds are very calm. Those are the times really of most concern. So the predominant health impacts, some of you I know have the Minisink report. We ran out of copies, but you can also find that on our website. That's available. The predominant health impacts were respiratory problems. We also included nosebleeds in that group, which is often, that's a common impact that we hear of at these sites. Seems like I don't have the numbers on that, but that is something that shows up quite a bit. Neurological problems. All the people who had some sort of neurological impact, they all reported headaches as well, pretty much across the board for that issue. And dermatological problems, these are skin rashes that tend to come and go. They'll get something, you know, they'll try topical ointments that don't really seem to help. The rash will eventually go away, but they'll show up again very unpredictably. We also did a survey called the SF36. This is a nationally validated survey that was, it was the RAND, that foundation or corporation that developed this survey on quality of life, looks at both physical and mental measures. And over half the respondents, when compared to the national statistic, were below normal for that SF36. So that seemed rather high to us. Okay, let me see if I can get this changed. Sorry, my slide is not changing. So I really want it to. There we go. Okay, so now I want to just show you an example of the particulate matter readings that we find. And I'm going to ask you to do me a favor and concentrate on the dots and not on those colored lines for what I'm talking about right now. The dots represent hourly averages of the PM2.5 found in a home or outside of a home, this is outside, over the course of about a month. So, and what I do want you to take a look at is the numbers along the side, the concentration of PM2.5 in micrograms per meter cubed. And you can see the highest peak is at about 300. And the lower peaks are around 75. Okay. So we do get minute-by-minute data with this spec that Dave's holding up over there. And that's a lot of data if you're recording for a long time. So we, at this point, we were averaging over an hour to be able to analyze the peak frequencies and heights. All right, let's see. Now, what this shows you is a 24-hour average. So we took that same data and averaged it over 24 hours. And if you look at the numbers on the side, you can see that that highest peak has dropped from 300 to about 130, 135. And those lower peaks that were 75 are now down to 20. So this just gives you an idea of what a longer averaging period does to the data and how it allows companies to say that they're meeting a standard that's low. And there may be peaks that are much higher, but if they're averaging over 24 hours or over a year, for heaven's sake, those peak levels will look like they're very low. So this is a really important piece of information that I think we feel needs to be brought to light, and one of our papers addresses that quite strongly. Another result we got at MiniSync, what this shows is that there were 7 occasions when we had more than one set of monitors at different houses showing peaks at around the same time. On October 30th, 3 out of 4 monitors that were running outside different homes recorded peak levels of, this is again micrograms per meter cubed, 3190 and 426. And on that same day, the recorded daily air quality index, which is put out by EPA, which is a regional index of air quality, the average for that day was 5.0. Okay, so that again, that kind of says to us that there are plumes of emissions that are moving through neighborhoods and affecting several houses at the same time. Okay. So all that put together, along with the VOC sampling that we did, I don't have a slide on it, but we did some sampling and found quite a number of the chemicals that we see often in Pennsylvania around well pads also showing up near the compressor station. Not as many, but there were still enough to make us believe that this is coming from the compressor station and not something else. So this was just a pilot study. It was really pretty small. We weren't expecting to find much, as David said. But so we were a little bit surprised at what we did find. And while the levels of VOCs were relatively low, if it's something that you're living with day in and out, and these peaks can come and go, we do think that's a public health issue that needs to be addressed. Okay, here we go. Okay, so now I'm going to move on, talk a little bit about what we're doing now in New York State. While we were doing MiniSink, that was also around the same time that we were addressing the FERC, the application to FERC and the comments that Beth was talking about. So, you know, suddenly there's a lot happening with compressor stations, a lot of permits, applications for permits across New York State. Madison County Department of Health was very interested in not only the report we did, but we also gave them a set of recommendations of what we thought he should do to do his own environmental health impact assessment. And quite amazingly, the Department of Health took this on, and they're really doing a full-blown assessment. We decided to join up with him and measure at four other sites. So we're looking at five compressor stations now along across New York State. And the Institute for Health and the Environment at Albany, University of Albany, they are helping us with some of the analysis of our data. Okay. So the goals and objectives are pretty basic. We want to assess health status of residents. The key here, though, is that we want to do it, we're doing it before a compressor station is built or expanded. Two of the sites have small compressor stations that are going to expand or are May, if they're permitted, they will be expanded. So built during construction where that is possible and during operations after it's operating, and also specifically during these blowdown events. And we're looking to do health surveys with as many participants as we can within a mile or a mile and a quarter of these sites. And then we do our monitoring of PM2.5 during those same times, before it's built, during construction, during operations and blowdown events. These are the parameters that we're looking at. Madison County, that's doing the full-blown assessment, is doing more than we're doing at the other sites. And I'll address kind of that basic outline later. But air quality, we're looking at PM2.5, VOCs, formaldehyde. He is also looking at radon in homes. I shouldn't say he, but the county. We do environmental home assessments, which gives us an idea of, because each home is a little different in terms of the kind of heat it uses, whether you use wood, heat with wood, things that might also affect your air quality. We want to know about that so we can account for it. So those home environmental assessments are very important. And these survey tools and assessments are also available online to communities that want to use them. They, in Madison County, are able to look at water quality as well, noise, even traffic, which is important, especially during the construction phase. For health issues, residents will fill out health questionnaires. If they're really good, they'll fill out a health diary, keep track of health effects that they're feeling off and on during the monitoring period. Madison County is also doing lung function tests. And they are also able to do a larger community health assessment looking at county health data and school nurse reports, EMS logs, and also complaint logs. So these are all things that would be excellent to do if you're a community wanting to start a monitoring program. Okay, so we're mainly, let's see. So there are four main monitoring events. Baseline is probably the most important. And if you think there's any possibility that something's coming into your town or through your area, we really highly recommend that you get some baseline data, even if it's just very minimal. Anything is better than nothing at all. Okay, and then construction is important, but probably post-construction more important than that. We're hoping to follow up 1 and maybe 2 years after with another cycle of monitoring and health surveys so we can track people over time. Okay, and so we're measuring basically at the individual level with the surveys, residences within a mile. We want to look at indoor and outdoor air. If there are particular sites that you're concerned about, schools, daycares, we think it'd be really important to try and get some baseline data at those sites as well. And if you can collaborate with local universities or groups, that can add a lot. We, in Madison County, Cornell University, and in collaboration with Oregon State, is doing some animal studies in the area. And so for regions where you have farms, that can be a big plus as well. The veterinary school there is helping out, is participating. And then just to give you a map, a sense of one of the sites, this again is Madison County. The inner ring is a half mile out, the large ring is a mile out. So they've marked where all the homes are. The ones in yellow, in that yellow area, are the ones that are downwind. It's mostly a west wind, and so they want to especially keep track of people who are downwind from the site. I think a lot of communities have the ability to do just a basic model, similar to what we're doing in New York, what we did in Manysink. If you've got the people willing to spend a little time on it, it really doesn't take too much. Again, it's really important to have that community organizer who kind of keeps people motivated and filling out their forms and getting them in and doing the monitoring at the right time, helping make decisions about when the best time to monitor is. So we would recommend that you have at least 4 residences that are within about a half mile, can be up to a mile of the site, for placement of the PM 2.5 monitors, one inside and one outside. The VOCs and formaldehyde sampling is what we do now, both with Summa canisters, and then there's a little badge that measures formaldehyde. And we place that out with the Summa canister, take a 12-hour sample overnight, and then you just send it off to a lab. So it's not that difficult to do. But It can provide quite a bit of good information. So, and then with health assessments, we have, again, the health survey, SF36. We do at all sites now, the home environmental assessment. And as many people as are willing to participate can fill out those health surveys. But it is a very good idea to have medically trained people review those forms with individuals. And here's a picture of the Dilos. Later, if you want to come up and get a close look, you can do that. That black monitor on the left is an earlier version of the spec monitor. Create lab at Carnegie Mellon University, after working with us for a while, has been developing these PM2.5 monitors, and they're getting better and better at it, so we have a newer model right now. This is the noise monitor that they're using in Madison County. They'll be using it inside homes and outside homes to get noise levels, again, before it's built, while it's being built, and after it's operating. Madison County's compressor station did just recently get permitted by FERC, so that one will be, I believe they're going to start constructing it this spring. And this is a Summa canister. You can get canisters to take just grab samples, very quick ones, or longer samples, 24 hours. We tend to think that 12-hour samples is a good amount of time, and something you can do overnight, and often nighttime is key in terms of emissions and possible exposures. Okay, so now I'm going to try something that could be tricky. I want to get into our EHP air model, which is how we estimate what the emissions would be at someone's home, and what you have to do to get the right information to figure that out. You have to determine what the source term is at the site. You know, what's coming out of the vent or the pipe at the compressor station. And we have come up with some estimates based on what we find in the literature and in public data that's been published. And then you want to measure the distance from the source to whatever residences you're concerned about. That's easy to do these days on Google Earth. You want to collect some weather data: wind direction, wind speed, cloud cover, day, and then time, day or night, are all very important to being able to do this. And then we've put together these charts that are available online and I'll show you one in a little bit, where you can just look up with all those factors and find out what the estimated exposure would be given local weather patterns. Okay, so now this is the tricky part, because I'm going to show you a short video that explains this air model thinking that we're doing. But I think I have to exit the show for a minute. Oh, yes. Okay, here we go. So, all right, I'm going to start it, and then is it showing up?
Yeah, but not.
Oh. Uh-oh. Oh, no. I don't know. It disappeared from my screen. Is somebody going to strike me? Oh, really? I can't even see it anymore.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, you should be able to see your cursor. Yeah. Very cool. Oh, that's a mirror. That's so weird.
So you have to go the other way.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
Okay, we're going to
I'm trying to get the cursor back. There we go.
Ooh. We'll start it over. Unfortunately, I don't know if I can get it any louder. Okay. This is tricky.
Sunny days with no wind.
You make it go full screen, too.
We all feel comfortable talking about the weather. Looks like rain. Wow, it's going to be a scorcher today. Cold enough for you. The weather is something that everyone can have an opinion about, and everyone usually does. But did you ever stop to think that weather can affect the amount of chemicals and other forms of air pollution that you and your family will be exposed to? Regular, everyday weather patterns influence how pollution moves through the air. If you know the weather and where pollution is likely to be coming from, you can actually estimate the potential impact on you and your family. This is very important for people living and working in areas where natural gas drilling is going on. A scientist in the 1960s named Frank Pasquale came up with a way to use weather conditions to understand how air pollutants move from their source to your house. Pasquale taught us that air and the gases and particles it carries with it travels differently depending on weather conditions. Here in southwestern Pennsylvania, we took Pasquale's model and applied it to the question, how do pollutants travel from natural gas drilling installations through nearby neighborhoods? Here's how it works. Sunny days with no wind cause air emissions to rise upward quickly, away from nearby residences. In this case, very few pollutants would reach a nearby home. This would be a good air day for people living near gas industry sites. Cloudy days with no wind cause air emissions to move slowly and closer to the ground. The pollutants linger. In this case, more pollutants would reach nearby homes and only gradually dissipate. This is a bad air day if you live near these sites. Sunny days with light to moderate wind allow the pollution to mix and rise more quickly, becoming less concentrated. Relatively moderate levels of emissions would reach nearby homes downwind. Wind on cloudy days causes air emissions to move from their source more quickly. On these days, moderate to high levels of pollution would reach nearby downwind homes. We developed a chart that can help you estimate the level of pollution reaching your home from a nearby compressor station, well pad, or condensate tank. At night, when it's cloudy and windy, you can expect something like this. On a night when it's cloudy, but not very windy, we can see that it's much, much worse. Somewhat higher. But as cloud cover increases during the day and wind slows down, air quality declines. Here's what you need to know to estimate health impacts at your location. 1. Where is the facility located relative to your home? How far away and in what direction? Remember, you may have multiple sources in different directions. You'll want to take account of all the nearby activity. 2, what is the weather pattern for the day or night? You can get that from weather reports. We also have a guide for you at our website.
It's quite tricky to do this. It's opposite from what you see on the screen, yeah. On the computer.
Got a little mirror thing going on. There you go.
Okay, thank you, Rose. Okay, well, so that was something we developed a couple of years ago for people in Pennsylvania. And we have improved on aspects of that. Of our chart, which I'll show you in a minute. But I did just want to go over in this table the exposure profile that's based on wind speed on the left. Let's say you go down to less than 5 miles per hour, and if you look across, you can see that during the daytime, for the most part, that's not going to be an issue because any emissions, when it's sunny, they're going to rise straight up. As you go further over to the right, if you have a... Oh, my. If you... I have no idea what... There's some noises over here. if you have a overcast day... Oh... I think I know what's happening. I think that... I apologize. I have to do something about that video. Let's see. You think I'm all right? No. Okay. Oh, thank you. Okay. Technologically challenged here. Okay. Oh, my. Let's go back. Let's see. Okay, here we go. Right? Yeah. Okay, so if it's overcast during the day, the impact can swiftly change from a low exposure to extreme, and then when you get to nighttime, you can see that with those low wind speeds, the impact will be quite high. If you go all the way down to where it's blowing more than 13 miles an hour, it really doesn't matter whether it's day or night. Those emissions are not going to stay close by for long at all. So if you're at home and you're looking at the weather pattern and you're wondering what might be happening for you, we do now have these charts online, and they are small. It's small numbers, but again, if you look, we have, this is based on an hourly emission per day of 300 grams per minute. So that's what we're using as the estimate for the source term, what's coming out of that that vent. And then if you, what you want to do is pick the distance that your home is from the house. Let's say you live 2 kilometers from the site, 1.2 miles. If it's a clear day with light wind, really most of the time you can scroll all the way down this chart and you're not going to see much. This is for VOCs. This is the continuation of that chart. So if you get down to cloudy skies 50% during the night, then you will see an impact. It'll jump to 100 micrograms per meter cubed. Okay. And again, some other nighttime conditions, you're going to have impact. So it can really vary dramatically based on what the weather is doing. And we know not everybody wants to get that detailed, so EHP has designed some other materials that make it simpler. This is actually from a, this is a magnet that we give to people to put on their refrigerators. It just gives them a very quick sense of, you know, they can look outside, see that it's a sunny day. They can check and see that that's not going to be a problem for them. They can let their kids go out and play without worrying at all. But there will be days when they would be better off not having their kids go out to play. And they'll be able to look at something like this and work with that information. And EHP has a lot of other kinds of materials that we put out for people. And so you can go to our website and find quite a lot if you're interested. And I'm just going to wrap up, so we're going to have a lot of time for...
I have a quick question about the rise of air quality in your show last night. Does that same guide apply to your presentation?
Yes, it could very well apply to many industrial sources of any kind.
Actually, we have a compressor station page in that guide.
Yeah. That chart was specifically for compressors, yeah. Really, I'm just going to wrap up now, and we have quite a bit of time where we can take questions, and if there are more people with index cards, you can pass them up front, and we can start asking some questions.
Do you want to start with some of them that we have?
Yeah, we have quite a few. So I think we're probably going to move up to the table so we can take turns answering.
See, they won't see the last slide.
Oh.
The names of people on.
Oh, sorry. That's where I was. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I did want to let you know that there are many people involved in this organization that make our job a lot easier. And Raina Ripple is an amazing director that keeps us working very hard, but we do have consultants everywhere from Maine to California who work with us on health issues, on air issues, so we really have an amazing group of people behind this organization. Okay. All right? Okay.
Yep.
Let's see.
I can't say it.
Sorry.
Questions that are specific. I don't know.
But can we? Should we go through the ones that people already submitted?
Yeah. Okay.
You ask, and we're getting questions together.
I'm sorry, because I don't. We're getting the questions together. Why don't you ask your question, and then we'll go to the cards. Okay.
Okay. I think should we all go up?
Up to fine.
Take turns or something.
Yeah.
Oh, they didn't do it. I think they're coming back up here.
Push it back a little bit, please. That's it. Hi, my name is Henry Gabriel. I live in Northfield. And I'm not too far away from the way they want to put a compressor.
Do you have a question?
Yes. Okay. I'm going to get to the question first. Can we get them... Can you people get this to stop and cease putting that compressor in Northfield now?
No.
No. We.
Okay.
No.
It's a really, really good question. We cannot do that. What we can do.
Okay.
Okay. We cannot, we don't have the ability to do that. What we can do... No, no. what we were trying to do this evening, this afternoon, was to show you there are certain questions that you should ask of the town, of the state of Massachusetts, I guess most of Massachusetts, and of FERC. One of the things that you could ask for, because you have rights, you could say, we want an adequate assessment of what's happening here. That probably is going to involve something called a health impact assessment. What Beth Weinberger was pointing out to you is that what they will give you is an 800-page document to say all the information is there. It's not all there. You have to analyze it. But if you can require that be done properly. So what we want to do is to have you asking the right questions with the right kind of information to be hopefully to be effective. Does that make any sense to you? Okay. Yeah. We'll get deeper into that. We'll get deeper into that.
You have questions?
Yeah, so there's a few questions that are sort of what we call how close is too close. You know, if 6 miles, how big is the radius? And I would say we're not certain, but when we work in communities with compressor stations, we're really concentrated on that, on a 1 mile radius, pretty much. That's our biggest concern. And then in some of the charts that you could see, some that Celia showed and some on our website, you'll see that in bad air conditions, it's a little further out. We would be concerned about your air quality. But really, we're focused on sort of a mile or maybe up to 2 miles as our biggest concern.
Other question? Yeah. You will get, if you allow somebody to average time out over 24 hours or 48 hours, they will be, or a week, there will be an argument that there are no exposures beyond some distance, 2 miles or something like that. If you say, no, I want to know what the short-term exposures are, then you find the distance out gets further. And if we've done a project where we've looked at topography to see what happens if you're downwind in a valley. So we have some information on that. So depending on where you are downwind in a valley is really important. But the thing to remember is that when those exposures occur, they are very, very high. You saw when Celia went down the list, she started at 1 when the weather was pretty hot, the wind was blowing and it was a sunny day. She got down to 100 when those values are intense. Those high exposures don't occur rarely. They occur about once every 4 days, there's a couple of hours when there's a potential for an exposure, like a high exposure, and an extreme exposure could occur every so many weeks. We do not know how often they would be because we haven't done modeling in Massachusetts. But if you go to Vermont, the state of Vermont does model for exposures, but not for compressor stations, and they will tell you short-time exposures can be very, very high. Now, the problem is that those short-time exposures that are outside of your house and very, very high, if you're heating your house inside, you're drawing air in, so the inside of your house will become polluted with it. And that will stay in the house for a long period of time.
So that's after the fact.
Right.
That's after the compressor. Mm-hmm.
Well, but the point is, no, wait. You have to make the argument to industry that this is the kind of a model, this is the kind of question you want answered. You don't want an average for a year or the tons per year answer. You want, what will the exposure be next to my house for whatever time it is, however far you are away? And if you don't get that answer, then they have not determined your health evaluation. The one thing that will drive this is health effects. If you can make a health argument, the state will often respond. But if you're making a compliance argument, it can be negotiated away. We'll talk to you a little bit later on that. Other questions?
One of the questions, I'm probably going to swing this back to you, Dave, is what happens to the waste that gets cleaned out of the pipeline through, there's something called a pigging process where they shoot through an object that cleans out what's in the pipeline. And I've not read anything that assured me of how that waste gets disposed of at the end.
Who asked that question? Well, then you know about pigging stations. The pipeline is an adventure to read about because actually the pipeline has to be maintained, because what happens is if there's any fluids in it, any water in it, things condense out on the inside of the pipeline, and sometimes they're it's a cage-like structure called a glycerate, which will jam up the valves. So they have to be cleaned out. So the way they clean it out is, and this is to the best of my knowledge, they'll take a device called a pig, which they put inside of the pipeline, and then they open the other end of the pipeline and they run the pig through, and I've heard of distances up to 10 miles, and everything comes out the other end of the pipeline as the pig goes through, picking up all this stuff and bending it into the air. Where it goes, God may know, but if it goes out during one of those poor air mixing days, it's going to go out right near where you are. And they like to do it at night because they don't think it bothers people too much, it seems. So, but if you're doing it at night on a cloudy day, that stuff's going to be right out, selling out right at the thing. It's a question. I know about this area. Yeah, and so, but you really have to pay attention to the weather, because somebody can come in as a consultant from Texas and say, oh, I know all about the weather. This is not Texas. This is Massachusetts, and the weather here is an adventure. Does that help you? Was that answer your question? Okay.
Okay, another here, there's a question. It says, Northfield is the site of one of the proposed compressor stations. We want the town to monitor air emissions. So how does the town determine where to put the monitoring stations and how many? The way we do it is we put monitors at people's homes because we're really concerned about health impacts. So we would suggest monitoring at the nearest residences or a number of residences further out
around, and
in all directions around the site. In terms of how many, that often comes down to budget issues for towns. These PM monitors are pretty inexpensive. They're about $200 a piece. You can discuss. And the VOC canisters are about $250 to monitor over with that kind of sampling. And formaldehyde badges are less than that. So a lot depends on budget, but it's certainly good to do. We suggest monitoring for about 32 days for each PM 2.5 monitor. And that's just enough for about three or four weather cycles to go through. So you get a sense of what kind of patterns of peaks you're going to get over that period of time.
And again, that's important because they will give you they will put a monitor out and measure a day or two. You don't care because you know that the wind is blowing at 13 miles an hour, you're not going to get anything on that monitor. So you've got to monitor at short periods of time over a long time. The monitors that we have cost about $200 each, but they record constantly. And we actually have a template, we call it, that helps us take that data off and say, okay, what would the people's exposure be? How many exposures would they have gotten over that period of time? What would the level of exposure be? What sort of health effects would we see? And we can validate that by comparing it against what the model told us what was happening over that same period of time. So we can get that data. You have to be careful because when we pointed that out at, was it Newmarket? The consultant came back and said, oh, the weather there is, everybody knows about the weather there, and gave a really answer that didn't, it was just not useful. Because I will assure you that if you put release something in a valley, and you don't, that there will be a point in time when there will be a high exposure at somebody's house in that valley, and it will not be once a year, it'll be much more frequent than that.
You can buy these specs. We can provide the website where you can buy them. Like we mentioned earlier, it's made by the Carnegie Mellon University made this. But for canisters, you don't own them, you rent them. So you have to return it back to the lab. The lab is called ALS Global. So they will provide, rent it for you for a certain period. You can sample it and send it back, and they'll send you the analysis.
Often the argument you'll get is it's too expensive, we don't have money. I'm going to throw a number out. If you wanted to do what we're doing in New York State, and you had the people who were willing to agree to organize it and get the information in, we think you could get the information, the baseline information, for a few $1,000, $4,000 or $5,000. If you wanted to do broader, more robust monitoring, and we would like to do more robust monitoring also, it would cost more. But we're not talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars. It's well within the reach of these communities, certainly the gas company. It's well within my reach if I decide to really do it. The EPA has used this monitor and has agreed that that monitor is accurate. That instrument also meets the standard, because what we're not trying to meet the EPA standard. What we're trying to do is identify the point in time when the peaks occur and how often they occur. They have criticized both monitors, saying this does not measure the same thing the EPA measures. You may not have figured out that I'm arrogant, but I said no one in their right mind would want to measure what EPA is measuring, because it's not the right thing. That somebody would want to measure it. But that's not the question you're asking. You're not asking what's the average exposure in Northfield for the next 12 months. You're asking in the next 3 hours what's going to happen at my house. The EPA monitor will not give you that information. You have to get something that's more precise and short term, but you have to get something that will record in the information for a long period of time. The spec monitor, that little white thing sitting over there, will actually measure, it'll measure forever, because it's got it just is recording it, but it easily could measure a year every minute. Never do that.
That's too much data.
Because if you put a year's worth of 1 minute information on your computer, you'll buy a new computer. But it's very manageable, and we spend a lot of time figuring out how to manage that. We do get the criticism that the spec monitor is not an EPA-approved monitor, and we agree it's not. Although we also run this monitor against the spec monitor, and I've run this monitor against the monitor at Sherwood Island, the Connecticut State monitor at Sherwood Island, and we get the same data.
So the monitors that the EPA are using are not as good, or they're not as accurate as the monitors.
EPA is more certain that it's measuring the exact micrograms of PM2.5, but it is not measuring it over time. It doesn't give you the time course of the measurement. So EPA's monitor, I would agree with them, probably gives you a better measurement of that piece that you want, that number. But that's not the question you have. You saw the numbers that we're looking at, 1 to 100. It does not matter if you get 85 and the number's 100. That's not where the uncertainty is in this device. The uncertainty in the EPA measurements are the time they're measuring them and the length of time they're measuring them.
Just a quick follow-up for someone asked about how to get the weather data. And airports in your area, usually if you find the nearest airport, they give very hourly information on all those weather parameters that we are talking about. But if you're just thinking in terms of your home and what's happening day to day, you can just go by the Weather Channel, you know, what's on TV. But if you want to get very specific data for analysis, then you can go to the airports.
You could also, if you wanted to know what would the exposure have been for the last year, if they had had that thing in Northfield, you can go to the National Weather Service and get the hourly measure, and you could use our model, and you could model it and say, if it was here, here's what I've been exposed to. You can do that.
And there's also an app called Aviation WX, which is used by pilots. You can use that to track the weather in your area.
We have a few questions about sort of our availability to collaborate. Do we collaborate with the universities and communities? And we do have a lot of university partners that we work with. And in terms of cooperating or collaborating with other communities, we're at the moment sort of maxed out right where we are with the New Yorks, but we would, you know, we love working with communities. So I think we'd love to hear from people who are interested in doing some of this work, and we are happy to talk and to share. I mean, as you've seen, we're happy to share with you what we know and how we do what we do.
Yeah.
Well, we could take some questions.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Chow. You can, if yeah. you can find New Haven, Connecticut.
Yes, you can. We're happy to meet with people in New Haven. Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah. Because FERC doesn't.
Okay.
Well, first of all, the question, as we saw at as Beth explained, the question has been formatted by the industry and FERC so that the answers that are rather general, not specific. The pushback that I advocate is go to the state and say, no, we want specific information on these specific points. Because the person who has to decide whether that's safe in your neighborhood or not is your local health director. And if the local health director said, this thing is not safe, it's not gone. Because the local health director has powers to make, his job is to make the place safe. One of the reasons we think you should get baseline data and you should get data after baseline is not because we approve putting the things in, but people are often a lot more reluctant to make wild guesses if they think that their guess is going to be challenged at the end. Somebody, yeah? There's a question way in the back.
Yes, I saw a little blurb on TV about some people who struck a match to their water supply in Pennsylvania and it caught on fire. Is that made up or is that true?
No.
Great, okay. The other part
is the water catches on fire. I mean,
the thing that really bothers me here is we have quite a number of family businesses that are organic farms and other related businesses. If this compressor station and these blowouts and pigs go along, they could ruin all that. But the other part is the pipeline industry and the energy industry does not recognize that nature does not follow their rules. And what I'd like to know, is there been a study of distances away from where the pipeline goes through and its effect on aquifers or the feeder streams to aquifers that are underground? I don't know how you track those and how far they go, but if they come through and they ruin our wells and our aquifer, then our homes, our whole neighborhoods are become worthless places to live.
We have done nothing on water supplies in New York or in Pennsylvania, but we do monitor water in Pennsylvania near the various facilities. Waste sites are a particular problem. And what you described is what happens. If we look at health effects, we take our people who we've got health effects from, and we look at those that have water in their house, groundwater in their house, the health effects are more intense in that group of people. We don't know how the water would be contaminated. We don't know enough about pipelines to know whether the pipeline would leak into the water table. But I think it's certainly a reasonable question to ask.
Well, there's going to be blasting. And I know blasting can affect wells and water supplies.
Yeah, that's not the gas. Yeah, you're absolutely right. But, yeah. This man, he's been trying.
Right in front, yeah.
Quick question. Somebody earlier said it's good to monitor when they're going to blow off. Do the gas companies tell the public if such an event is about to happen?
Oh, God.
No.
Well, yeah, actually, no. They tell them that many think they told them that they would do it. And they did tell them that they did it, but they didn't tell them before they did it. But the people at Minisink actually managed to grab a sample when they were blowing it off at one point. It's really hard because the gas, the SUMA canister is what you want at that point in time. We could see it on the spec anyway. The SUMA canister data is what you want. The problem is that it's $200, you know, and are you going to open the valve and blow $200 now, or are you going to wait 10 minutes? It's very hard to do.
And I think communities are interested in seeing if that's one of the places they can put pressure on when whatever negotiations occur, if any negotiations occur, is that communities would really love to know when that's going to happen. And for the most part, it seems like it should be doable for the industry unless it's some sort of crisis. But it would be great because that is, I think, one of the worst times to be within a mile of a compressor station.
You know, the compressor stations are run out of the gas going through the pipeline. That's where the energy comes from to run them. And the gas that goes through the pipeline is of varying quality depending on where it came from. So the emissions will be of difference depending on what they're running through the pipeline. And a question that's often asked, and occasionally answered, is what are you going to put in the pipeline? What is there and how much you're going to emit from it? Yes?
It seems as though it seems to be worse at night, the exposure.
Yeah.
Why is that?
It's because at night the air, the ground doesn't warm up. It gets cold. And the pollutants tend to stay near the ground because there's not a lot of vertical mixing, is why that happens. You'll see it. You get up in the morning and go outside, and you'll see that there's a little mist around. And if you look at the leaves on the trees, they're not moving at all. You do that, and have a cup of coffee, go back in, and have another cup of coffee, go back out, and you see the leaves beginning to move, and the mist is gone. That's actually what happens. Yeah.
Yeah, for baseline air quality monitoring before any of this happens, what is the best way to do it? You have to do it like you find your, half a dozen residences or whatever within 2 miles. I mean, more than half a dozen, more than 40,000 horsepower station. But then, would you just monitor one day or one calm night for the particulates and the
No, you.
Return or a period of time? How would you do
I'll tell you what we do, and that's presuming that we know what we're, that's what we do is we measure for 34 days. We draw and we do, and it's that meter. A group of eight of those meters are set out, one outside of each house, one inside of each house, for, at different locations. We measure for eight for 34 days. Usually we try not to do it in the middle of the winter because the winter's the winter. And then we actually draw Summa canister data when we think the weather is tending to give us an inversion, so we can see what's there. At the same time, we give. At the same time, we ask people to fill out the their medical questionnaire. That data is all HIPAA. It's privileged. We don't give it to anybody. So you would get a medical evaluation of everyone that's there. We do the compound we call the SF36. Because that allows us to take, if I do an SF36 today, and then I come back 3 months from now and do another one, it will track my health status between that time. And that's a very good device. It's what physicians use for people who've had heart attacks to see if they're recovering. So it's a very good device. So that's what we would do. We would probably do it with a group. We also model the air during that time. Does that help you? I obviously think that if we could do in Massachusetts and in the same as we're doing in New York and in Pennsylvania, then we'd get a stronger overall data set. Yeah, go ahead.
Can we get a question about the distance?
Coming to the question about the distance from the site, we ideally do it within a mile, the residents living within a mile. And you can do beyond that, but that would be more like a control group than an actual residents. Okay.
We have some questions for over from over here. We've never had the gas company fund it, and I'm not sure that's a terrific idea.
Well, but I intended on asking them up front if there are any health risks associated with emissions, and if they say no, then I'm going to ask them, and I'm going to try ask them if they would consider funding this baseline stuff.
I would think that would be good. Wouldn't you? Yeah, and
well, this is a good place to live.
That'll happen with these compressor sites, do you think?
Excuse me?
That'll happen.
It depends on who's enforcing the state law. So in Massachusetts, it's up to the local boards of health to do that.
Huh. Yeah. Well, I will say that we find that if you can get health departments on board, that's a big plus. They'll work very hard for you. Did you?
I'm the chair of the Board of Health and Urban and have been for about 2 years now. I've been on the board longer. We requested Kinder Morgan a long time ago specifically to come and talk science to us because I've been studying this now for 2 or 3 years. My hat's off to you. You guys know way more than I do, but what I learned scared me. And so I said, come talk to us. So they sicked their attorneys on me. And they basically said local boards, no matter what you are, especially boards of health, are non-jurisdictional in a federally mandated project, okay? So in your experience in dealing with obviously different states, did you get FERC to order that this whatever project follow state regs and then implement those state regs? Because you know, whatever town you live in, they don't care about your regs
right.
at all.
Yeah.
Don't even think for a second that your local regs are going to hold up against a federally mandated project. Okay?
So, well, I can say that at least in New York, these projects do have to get state air permits and water permits. So people at the state level can stop it if they don't give those permits out. I'm not sure how it is in Massachusetts.
Those are all under the federal guidelines, so they would go by federal air quality standards.
State.
Yeah, I think it's state.
But isn't that have to be mandated by the FERC licensing process? If they don't mandate that the state regs, because that's where the Conservation Commission, I'm on that too, and we've been trying to figure out how does a state Conservation Commission approve, this is off topic, say something, they're going to do horizontal drilling from one side of the river to the other. Mm. You came to me as a permitting body, I'd laugh you out of the room, because
right.
I'm never, ever in a million years going to permit that. However, a federal permit will permit that, and they'll come in and say, well, little local boards, this is above your pay grade, right? We'll take care of it. And that's the same process that happens with boards of health. We say, we want you to do this. They say, we have much better regulations, much more applicable to our project, back to FERC. What's FERC's
right.
job?
Mm-hmm.
FERC's job is not to monitor or give a crap about our health. Their job is to green light gas lines or whatever.
Right.
Just giving us that little shot to intervene. And so on your experience, you were able to at least intervene with state regs, right?
In order to apply
these quality standards. And then once you get to apply them, what can you do to them to have them adjust those standards to get them lower? Does that make sense?
Your question makes sense, and we don't have a sensible answer to it, but or maybe you have a sensible answer.
No.
To it. Okay.
So
wait. I just.
The local has the same power as the state.
Yeah. It's a. I think the one thing that we found about gas line attorneys is that they don't have a lot of knowledge about what state powers are. Well, I wouldn't accuse somebody else of lying, but anyway, I worked in a health department. I worked for the CDC. The person who has absolute authority is the person enforcing the health code. The health code is sacrosanct. The gas company doesn't realize that, but the health code is sacrosanct. And if you push on it, and you get your legislators to also push on it, and there's legislators in Connecticut at state and local levels who are asking these hard questions of how can you just run roughshod over these communities and these community laws? They're gonna fight you, and they might win, but you have an edge. I think you also have an edge when you could say, and I'll be back when I've got all these ruined farms, you might want to pay for them. Yeah, person with Vermont on.
I have one other question. One of those charts you showed, based upon the wind speed and direction, one chart showed the emissions right across the board, low, 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 low.
Yeah. It's being diluted. It's going to the upper air system and being diluted, and that's why when you have a lot of what we call vertical mixing, which can be several hundreds of feet, and a lot of wind, then it's just dispersed.
Though when it goes up that high, I mean it's still there and it still travels. I mean there is a study from Maryland, right?
That was a great study.
Yeah. That talks about air impacts coming from Ohio and Pennsylvania.
The point I'm trying to make is that we have a project on the table by Eversource Spectrum to place 3.4 million gallon LNG tanks. I assume there's going to be a compressor station here. And there are two schools with 1,000 kids within a mile, or approximately a mile. So even if the weather conditions say low, 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 would that put those children in those locations at risk?
Yeah, I think you didn't understand the chart completely. That was the point in time when they were low, low, low. There was other times when they were high. We didn't talk about susceptible populations, and I apologize. Schools, there's absolutely clear data that these things will precipitate asthma attacks. There's no question. There's hospitalization data.
Can you speak up?
There's clear data that these things will precipitate asthma attacks. And if you've got children who are asthmatic in your school, that school is going to be impacted. So that's a susceptible population. People with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease is a susceptible population. Pregnant women are a susceptible population. People with cardiac conditions, according to the New York, Pennsylvania study that was done by Johns Hopkins, look like people that are susceptible. So, and if you're a mile away, you'll get exposures. Somebody over here. We can show you what we're doing in New York State, if that would be helpful.
Yeah, that model template is available for communities to use. Yeah.
Okay. Somebody hasn't asked a question yet.
Just a general question. Given that FERC has the ultimate authority of approving these projects, I mean, common sense tells me that they should play a more of a role in ensuring public safety of the surrounding folks who are exposed to these various projects. Is there any pressure on FERC to play more of a significant role in really looking at the health effects and the overall quality of folks? Yeah.
We came to tell you what we're doing, so we're getting a little bit out of our territory. EPA actually does have the ability to go to FERC, and we talked to Region EPA and Region 2 New York, and they were very positive about working and using information we were giving them. So I would use everything. I would use the local regional EPA. I'd use your local. Your environmental departments, your health departments. I would not use anything. There's no golden bullet. This lady's been asking.
Yeah, Dr. Brown, you talked a little bit about radioactivity and radon and natural gas. Can you explain what that means and how it in any other ways frack natural gas differs from traditionally sourced natural gas, if it's contaminated with frack fluid or in any other way?
There isn't a lot. I can talk a little bit about it. It seems that the natural gas that we had been getting from domes didn't have the same sort of health impact that we see here. We don't know exactly what the chemicals are that are in the fracked gas, but we have some information on flowback water. We do know that lightweight hydrocarbons, this is probably more than you ever wanted to know, that lightweight hydrocarbons appear to be coming out of the natural gas, out of the fracked gas. We think that they're coming out of the rock that's been fracked. We think that formaldehyde could be coming out of that too. But nobody has measured it. And part of the problem is that even in the water samples that have been measured in Pennsylvania, the water wasn't collected in a way to trap those lightweight compounds, because you have to collect the water without letting it ever see air. Once the gas sees air, the lightweight compounds are gone. And we think that's what's happening in the showers. The people that get sick in the showers, we think they're being exposed to that. But we haven't written any papers about it.
Yeah.
Okay.
might not have airports for air quality data that is reasonable. So can't we, or should we all be asking for like a year's worth of monitoring data before they even start? That's a good thing to ask for, right?
I think so, and you could model it for a year before they start. You could show what it would be. If you can ask, what will be the emissions? Not the tons per year. What will be the highest hourly emissions that will be released from this, and what will be in them?
And well, just quickly, for weather station, also, you know, Madison County got a little weather station and set it up. So that doesn't cost too much. That's a possibility. Sure.
That also gives us an extra year to figure out what's going on here.
Yeah.
You know, if they have to do that data first, that's a reasonable thing to ask for, isn't it? Because it's the same changes to what it's
I think the argument that if we were trying to make is what we were made today is that we know that there are acute, those effects, short-term effects occurring in people. So we know people are being exposed to something. We know that some of the chemicals are carcinogens and neurotoxins and have long-term effects where you're not even going to see the effects for several years or generations. We know that there are low birth weights in Pennsylvania near these gas fields. We know there's evidence out of Colorado that there is changes in heart condition. I don't remember exactly the data, but there's effects that are seen out of there. So these are not things that you're dreaming up. There are scientific peer-reviewed papers that are saying that this is happening. At these papers are coming out every week, or every month. So it is not a question of you've coming up with some harebrained idea that there's health effects. There are health effects. And there's no question that there are exposures. There are exposures. And there's no question that nobody knows that people haven't defined what people are being exposed to. There's no question of that either. And I personally think that it's absolutely within your, you know, I would demand it. A health impact assessment is what you want, and they will know what you're talking about.
Yeah. And they won't really want to do it.
And they'll tell you no. Go ahead.
In the light of all of the research that you just cited, if you know, what presentation of all of this evidence has been made to the CDC and or Public Health, and what efforts are being made for those agencies to inform our federal government and the gas industry that there is a widespread and unacceptable risk, for example, comparable to blanketing all of our environment with secondhand smoke, which is certainly a hazard they all recognize.
We've met with CDC, with ATSDR at CDC. We've never met with the federal government. We know that a study was attempted at Pavilion, Utah, Pavilion, Wyoming, where they drew blood samples from people in a gas field, and they wanted to see what was in their blood. And CDC had the only laboratory to analyze it. They agreed to analyze it, and then when the blood was drawn, they refused. And Health Canada was asked to do it, and Health Canada refused because the United States had said they didn't want them doing blood in the United States.
So a lot of it's politics.
It's politics. You're not dealing with a weak opponent.
Mm-hmm. Yes, in the back.
I would be giving you what I think. We don't have specific data. I think the fallout, I think the lightweight hydrocarbons are not going to get in the water from fallout because they've gone into the air. If you're worried about radioactivity, that could be a problem over a long period of time because this thing is going to be running a long period of time. If there's a leak in the gas line and the compounds are in the gas line and that's in the aquifer will be contaminated. If you take what we've seen in Southwest Pennsylvania, people, that's where the people light their water. They people will describe getting in the shower and getting and having the shower burn them on the front and then burn them on the back, and then they have rashes from that. And they will also talk about taking a shower and then getting a headache and getting nauseous.
But you won't find
but
research
you won't find
at this
research
point.
On that on gas lines.
Yeah, on compressor stations. The research that we see is all where there's drilling, and that's where the risks seem really clear. The research that's been done has been done on shale plays where they're drilling. And so they're fracturing, you know, really close to people's homes and their wells. And, you know, the effects of people who have, you know, water they can ignite or water that's the wrong color and things that are making them sick. That research is all by where there's fracking and impoundment pits. So we don't know in terms of compressor stations out here.
I think one thing that's really important, Dr. Giampoli might want to, is that you've got to be, somebody with medical training has to look at the health information. I'll give you an example. We had a nurse practitioner who was going to people's houses and evaluating patients. And she came here and she said, came to New Haven, and one day she said to me, one afternoon she said to me, they have aphasia. And I said, first of all, because I'm so bright, I said, what's aphasia? She said, they forget words. I said, well, I forget words, I'm 70 years old. And she said, no, these are young people, can't remember a word. That was only seen because a medical person interviewed, I said, they know they have aphasia? She said, they don't know it. She says, I see it. And I think what you were saying from the very beginning, when CJ came to join us, he said, the doctors have to get involved.
Yeah, the doctors will be able to ask the right questions, like specific, like, you know, for example, like Dr. Brown mentioned earlier, when you say headache, it can be, you need to get specific information before you know exactly why the headache is happening. Is it just because you have a problem like, you know, a migraine headache or a cluster headache, or maybe it's coming from the chemical exposure? So the medical practitioner will be able to take the right information and give you a good feedback compared to doing it yourself.
So,
okay.
I'm going to recommend that you can contact the Department of Health in Madison County. They are doing water tests as part of our compressor station project, and they would happily share with you the different kinds of tests they're doing because they're doing wells and surface waters. So that would be a good resource.
Yeah. That's really good.
This problem is very complex for a variety of reasons, as we all know. And one of it has to do with the lack of understanding by not only lay people, but also our legislators. We were just bringing some bills before our science, technology, and engineering committees for the state of New Hampshire, and it was clear that many of them didn't know much.
much at all about the pipeline issues. One of the things that I'm wondering about is when you're trying to gather data that has some sort of impact, you need to make sure that the protocols are consistent from place to place so that we don't get into a tangle of someone arguing with us about the validity of the data because we're not looking at apples and apples and oranges and oranges. So my question is, yes, two things. One is, what do you think is the possibility, because in a way we have a really, if you're a researcher, exciting opportunity to look at communities all along a pipeline. In our case, mainly I'm talking about the NED in Oregon, but there are others. So there are other pipelines, but nonetheless there are a lot of commonalities. So is there a way to get a unified research data project initiated across the communities, and then once that's there, where does the data go? Where's the clearinghouse? So, or where could the data go? Where could the clearinghouse be? So that this data is then out there and then shared in a more consistent way, so that again, we have the strength as sort of local people at large, because we are now many communities speaking with one voice.
Okay. We, in terms of protocols, all of our protocols, well, our protocols are designed, I worked at CDC, they were designed based on investigations we'd done at Superfund sites. Okay, so that doesn't mean that I wasn't wrong, but it means that we have some. We'll share those with you. I think you probably need to get organized on an interstate basis to get what you want done. You may actually have to form some, you may have a group of people that's organized, but there needs to be a plan. You need to be careful because you don't want somebody to come in and do research on you. You don't maybe not mind that, but you want information that's focused on your health issues. But you probably are gonna have to bring some people together, thoughtful people together, and say, okay, this is what we want. Massachusetts has a very good health department and a very good DEP, and they sometimes talk to each other. And there's a group of, there's an interstate collaborative groups here in New England, the Northeast States for Environmental Air Use Management, NESCOM. It's the Northeast States for Environmental Air Use Management. There's an organization of people who have done things like this for issues. I don't know whether they would do it, but you need to get somebody together. Now, where to keep the data? My view is, the person who gives you the information, it's their data. We don't give health names out to anybody. But we bring our data together. We will share it with anyone who wants it. The CDC hasn't been terribly interested. But that doesn't mean that your legislator can't come out and say, we want these three health departments to do it. Because in Colorado, the Colorado Health Department passed a law that they would collect health data on people and form a registry near the gas fields. But it's a political, I don't think you're going to do it overnight.
Exactly. I know that our concerns from New Hampshire, because we're from New Hampshire, but obviously we're in connection with our neighbors along this pipeline. And it was very disturbing just 2 days ago, or 3 days ago now, when we were listening to our science and, you know, tech and energy committee asking questions so that they could try to look at some bills that had nothing to do, sort of had to do with health, but more specifically on that. And Kinder Morgan was answering questions by saying things like, well, you know, methane is light, so it just rises.
Yeah.
It doesn't have an effect.
80% of the gas is methane.
Exactly.
20% is something else.
And then also, listening to
supposedly fell underneath the
minor source, yeah.
So I'm trying to ferret out here how we can even work with our Department of Environmental Services, and perhaps what we need to do is to go to our New Hampshire State Health Department, who are not, as I know, maybe my colleagues here from New Hampshire can answer that or not.
The state, it's probably worth, this is a guess, calling Arthur Marin at NESCOM, Northeast States Fair Use Management. That's an organization of Maine, Connecticut, Rhode Island, New England, Massachusetts, New York, and New Jersey's health departments and environmental departments in Vermont. And they operate as a consortium for those states. Arthur Marin's a director. Marin, M-A-R-I-N. You're probably going to have to, I hope he's still there, but if you go and, you're probably going to have to get into his office and tell him what you want. But that's... It's in Boston.
One word at a time.
Northeast States. Four.
Four?
Four.
F-O-R.
Air Use Management.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, why would you ever name an organization that?
So that no
legislator can ever figure out what it is, so they'll never defund it.
Just a quick reminder, we really only have 5 more minutes in this space before our rental period's up.
Okay. Speak. No, they're interview functions. We have tried to do FEV ones, but we haven't been. They're very hard to do in the field, and we're not sure about that. We do have some people at Yale who would like to go into a community and do respiratory studies in a compressor station, an area with a compressor station. Well,
that would be a grant funded.
We try to get a grant to do that. This program, by the way, we should have said at the beginning, was all funded by the Heinz Endowments in Pittsburgh. It was the New York Studies funded by the Park Foundation. We have other work is being funded by the Pittsburgh Foundation and some by the Keneal Foundation. And then some anonymous people who send us money. Sure.
Two more, and I think that'll have to be it. Oh, well, there was someone back here. Yeah, yeah.
Just a couple of silly engineering questions.
Oh.
The compressor you just studied, is it indoor installation or an outdoor installation?
Well, it's in a building. It's covered. Yes, it's housed.
Did you do any work to try to relate the emission peaks you were seeing to blow down valve openings, et cetera, other things going on within the compressor station at near time?
We know that they were going down at those times, and we could see it in our records, but we're not able to actually. We don't have precision. We weren't on the site to actually see what was going on, so we. They were blowing. They were having blowdowns. Yeah. One of the most critical things for a group like us is that we're credible. When we say something, we want to be able to say, okay, this is a guess, or this we can support. And so we're very careful about going out, about how we present information. Because if we lose our credibility, you've lost us. Go ahead.
Okay, one last question.
I came off from upstate New York, and besides the monitoring you're doing there, I'm on the Dominion line further downstream from Madison County in Minden.
You're where?
Besides the monitoring, another thing that New York's doing that's going to be really helpful here maybe is to stop, have to stop the Constitution pipeline. If the Constitution doesn't get built, the Northeast Direct might not get built, they may put New York on a whole course of not building any of this infrastructure. We may set an example. So I just want to say, you can go on the internet to stop the pipeline, the Constitution pipeline, and there's a toll-free number there for Governor Cuomo, and he's being inundated. He has to make a decision by the end of April. And so if we can, everybody in the whole Northeast can push Cuomo to say no to the Constitution pipeline, the Northeast Direct may never even happen. And the other last thing I want to say is FERC, in case people don't know it, I believe there are five commissioners. At this point, I think every single one of those has either been appointed or reappointed by President Obama.
Right.
And they're sort of like the Supreme Court. They don't answer anybody, although they don't have a lifetime term. But that gives you an idea of how important it is to pay attention to the presidential election. And I think you'll see that there's only one candidate on the other side.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.